amazing day it is to worship the Lord this morning. We want to welcome you all the way from New Delhi, India, the capital of the great nation of India. And we just want to let you know that we're sending our worship, we're sending our praises and our adoration. And we're lifting it up to you, Jesus. Father, what can we give to you than our worship? Just ask the Lord this morning or evening, whenever you're hearing this telecast, what can you give the Lord, who is the maker of heaven and earth? What can you give to him? He looks to and fro on the earth, looking for true worshipers, the word of the Lord says. Father, enable us to worship you. We shout praises of joy and adoration.
Just
to you, Lord Jesus. The commitment I have, Lord Jesus, to the promises that you have given me, Lord. Lord, I believe with everything in my heart. Nothing compares, nothing, Lord Jesus. Lord, I want to declare even my successes don't compare to the promises that you have. Because we consider the promises of God to be something better. And when we are in trials and tribulations and situations of doubt, we think that God's promises are yes and amen. But I want to give you a piece of information that even though you're doing well in your life, and you're not in the will of God and what God wants you to do, I want you to know that His promises are still more than enough for you, Lord Jesus. Because it's your blessed assurance. Say, Jesus is mine. And oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of His Spirit. Jesus, but you are washed in His blood. And this is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day.
Praising my Savior. sun came up and the wind may come, I will stand steadfast.
Trust in you because I have no other option. I don't put my trust in you because I don't have any money, I don't have anything to offer in this world or anything to offer this my family or my friends, but I trust in you because there has been nobody, and when I say nobody, I mean nobody, who has done for me what you have done. Lord, I don't come to you because I have no option. I come to you because you are my only option, Lord Jesus. Lord, I pray, let the Spirit of God move. Let the worship of the Most High God convict us. Let the presence of the Most High God, let the presence of the Holy Spirit be amongst us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Praise the Lord, my dear friends. Hope you enjoyed that time of worship. And as we get ready to listen from the Word of God, today I would like to talk about a topic which is very near to my heart. And I think it would make sense and it would resonate with many of you, because this is something which happens in all of society even today. And I wanted today to talk about a very interesting and an important topic that needs to be spoken about in the church, which is the problem of partiality. Yes, my dear friends, we may think that our Christian walk is stemming on our holiness, which is there, our the way we talk, the way we sing, the way we worship. But I want you to know that there is an inward work that needs to happen in our lives, which should show the world that we are followers of Jesus. We are not supposed to be believers, but we have to be followers and disciples of Jesus. That's why Jesus says, go make disciples to the ends of the earth. And this is a very important topic to talk about, partiality. We may think that this has no relevance in today's world, but in a country like India, in a church of India, this is the most relevant topic. James chapter 2 verse 1 says, my brothers, show no partiality as you hold faith in our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory. For if a man wearing a gold ring and fine clothes comes into your assembly, and a poor man in shabby clothes also comes in, and if you pay attention to the one who wears the clothing and say, you sit in a good place, while you, the poor man, you stand over there or sit at my feet. Have you not made distinctions among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts? What is partiality? There was a man that went into the church. This man went to a church in South Africa. And as he was going into the church, the leader of that church said that you cannot come to this church because this church can only have white people. No colored people allowed in this church. And then that person said, if the church is going to be just like the world, what's the point of me coming to church? You know who this person I'm talking about? I'm talking about none other than the father of our nation, Mahatma Gandhi. In 1987, Richard Adams and Absalom Jones, they were not allowed to enter a white church because it was not allowed for white people and black people to have to be in the same vicinity. Now, you may be thinking that I'm talking about something which happens in other countries. If you think even in the Pentecostal movement in the nation of India, we have separate Church of God, separate churches and names with special initials on it, which means they are for the lower classes. Partiality and prejudice is still a very much part of our church fabric. What is partiality? If I was to define what is partiality, partiality is illegitimately
elevating yourself over others. It is you discriminating somebody to meet the cultural expectation which is not found in the Bible. That is what partiality is all about. You are supposed to discriminate, my friends. You are supposed to discriminate darkness from light. You are supposed to discriminate sin and holiness. You are supposed to discriminate all these things. But today I want to let you know that partiality is something which is so rampant in our society, so rampant in our church, so rampant in our culture. Our whole fabric of our nation is formed on caste system. People who decide we can have and we cannot have, people who are worthy of having, people who are not worthy of having, people who are worthy of having an education and people who are not worthy of having an education. What is it all stemming on? But I want to let you know that anybody that tries to divide, anybody that tries to put down based on culture, based on race, based on financial status, based on education, based on color of skin, based on background, social, economic backgrounds, I want to let you know anything which is not part of the Word of God and it is used to control and to elevate yourself above everybody else in the name of whatever it may be is called partiality. And God is against partiality. I want to talk about what is the problem of partiality. Is it bad to be rich? Is it bad to have good things? Is it bad to drive a good car? No. But the fact of the matter is, if you drive a good car, to give you the permission to talk bad about a person who comes in a bicycle, that is partiality. You are supposed to enjoy everything in your life, and I want to let you know today, if you think that just because you have a car, just because you have a good education, just because you look good, just because you smell good, just because you have good clothes, it makes you better than anybody else, I have news for you, my brother, my sister. You are not even this much better than anybody else. Because in my worldview, I see the richest people committing suicide. I see the most powerful people falling out of a building. I see the most prestigious and popular women having poison and killing themselves, overdosing on sleeping pills. Why? Because they're not happy. I want to let you know that God stands against partiality. Numbers chapter 12, if you see, God stood against partiality that Aaron and Miriam were doing against Moses because he married an Ethiopian woman. They tried to question the man of God, and God said that he gave leprosy to Miriam because she opened her mouth against the man of God. Why? Because God does not believe in partiality. I want you to know, and I would like to continue on with this topic in my next week, but today I want to let you know, and I want to come to a close today, that if you feel you are entitled to be partial towards others, I want to let you know to check yourself today. Check yourself on who you are today. Wherever you are, whatever you've been able to achieve in your life, it's not because of you, but it's because of the goodness of God in your life. And if you ever think for 1 minute that you deserved it, I want to let you know you didn't. But God gave it to you anyway because of your faithfulness. Because God's grace is sufficient for you. And just because there's a guy there who has absolutely nothing, it does not give you the right, or it does not validate you to speak down to him and speak lesser to him. And next week I'm going to tell you why it's so important and what happens really if you have partiality in your life, in your family, in your church. God bless you, and let's pray and ask the Holy Spirit to teach us, to guide us, to make us navigate through this problem of partiality, so that in a world that believes in all kinds of castes, let the church stand as a beacon of light, standing for truth, standing for justice, standing for equality, standing for all the things that God stands for, and most of all, stand for love. God bless you all.
I greet you all in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ this morning. What a joy and a privilege it is for us to come in the presence and worship our living Savior. Hallelujah. Right through the Bible we see people worshiping the Lord, falling down at His feet for all the things that God has done. Falling at His feet, falling in His presence, falling prostrate on our face on the ground, not out of fear, out of gratitude, out of love, out of adoration, but He deserves all our respect, all our dedication. Amen. But these are all added as part of the worship to God. That's how it is, friends. Do you enjoy worshiping the Lord? I believe that one of the things that shows, that proves that somebody is spiritual is their attitude towards worship. I know the people, when they get saved, they're so excited to come to the presence of God. You remember those days? The early days of your salvation, your born again experience? Think about that time. The worship is by 10 o'clock, the worship service. You are there from 9:30. You are the first one. Even before the pastor comes, you are there. Why? Because of the excitement of the desire to worship the living Savior. You are there. You don't know how to sing. But when they are leading the songs, you are trying to sing. You are singing the best way you know. But you're singing because you want to worship the Lord. You're enjoying every moment. Everything that is done during that service. Reading the psalm. You are the one who is reading loudly, louder than anybody else. You're the one who is raising your hands, praising the Lord. You are the one shaking your head when the pastor is preaching. 2.5 hour service. Everybody's gone. You're sitting there. Why? Because you're enjoying God's presence. That's what happens when we enjoy worshiping our Lord. And nowadays you see the same person being a believer for a long time, now he gets bored. He doesn't come to church on time. He comes late after everybody has come, sitting in the last row. He doesn't want to sing anymore. He thinks the pastor is preaching too long. He's looking at his watch all the time. Why? The spark, the desire of worship is gone. It should not happen to you and me, friends. It should never happen. God wants you and me to be always worshipers. More than anything else, more than any other situation, we should be worshipers. Amen? I want to share with you a message that God has put in my heart for you. Protected by God. That's the title of my message. Let's read a verse. In verse 2, or let's read verse 1 and 2. So, yeah, I didn't say Genesis chapter 32, I'm sorry. Genesis chapter 32, we're going to read verse 1 and 2. So Jacob went on his way, and the angels of God met him. When Jacob saw them, he said, "This is God's camp." And he called the name of that place Mahanaim. Mahanaim. That's what he called Mahanayim. What is the meaning of Mahanayim? Mahanayim means the camp of God. It's a camp of angels. That's what a Mahanayim means. He had just finished with a big argument with his father-in-law Laban. He came after them because his daughter has taken away his gods, the idols. She hid it. He couldn't find it. And he rebuked Jacob for leaving without saying goodbye to him. Anyway, the conversation all went, but God interfered. God told Laban not to fight with Jacob. God told Laban to be nice and good to Jacob and the family. That's what he did. So we see here in chapter 31, they put a heap of stones and they called it as a witness between Laban. Laban says, between you and me this day. He called the name of the place Galeed, but Jacob called it Mizpah, which means may the Lord watch between you and me. So that's how they parted. And when that happened, now the angels met with him. Hallelujah. There's always a connection between heaven and earth for God's people. If you are a child of God, there's a connection between you and heaven. For you, the heaven is always open. The angels will come and visit you. The angels will come and let you know that God has appointed them to take care of you, to protect you, to go with you. That is the job that God has given to the angels, to take care of you and me. Amen. Many times God speaks and says, your house is my name. Your house. Not only for the life of Jacob. God is telling you today, your house is my name. You know that? It is a camp of God. It's a camp of the angel. Hallelujah. The house of every believer is a house, a camp of the angels. No matter where you are, no matter how poor you are, no matter the struggles that you go through, I want you to hear me today. Your house is a Mahanayim. It is a camp of the angels. Amen? Hallelujah. You know, people keep securities around their houses. Gunman wandering around. Security cameras everywhere. Even this, I'm talking about even believers. When you have made some money, that is how you behave. Because you're worried about your finance, your wealth. You're worried about the money that you're keeping in the house. You're worried about the thief stealing it away from you. So we want to protect ourselves. So we are doing it the way that the world does. Such a strong gate. Electronic gates. Nobody can open it unless you press the button. And then the cameras are sitting everywhere. And then the security guards. And if you're very rich, you've got a gunman standing there. How much they can guard you? You know the story of the horrible killing of our late Prime Minister, Indira Gandhi. She had everything. She had all the securities. She had all the protection. But what happened? Finally, her own security guard turned the gun and shot her. Friends, I want you and me to know that only the Lord can guard you and me. How can He guard us? Not with guns, not with gadgets. No. God will guard you and me with His angels. Hallelujah. He will guard you within and without, inside and outside, wherever you go. In the car, in the bus, in the scooter, walking, trains, no matter where you are. The angels of God will be there. Amen. Jacob will call it God's host. He will call the angels as God's army. That's what Jacob will be calling them. Amen. What is the psalmist writes? Psalmist writes like this, and he says, the angels of the Lord encamp around those who fear Him. You remember that psalm? The angels of God encamps around those who fear Him. All you need to do is you must fear God. You must belong to Jesus. That's all you need. That's all I need, my dear friends. I always travel alone most of the time. Whenever I'm going to preach, all over the country I travel. Most of the time in trains and buses and jeeps. The planes won't get to those places. And in the early days, I never traveled by plane. I traveled only by train and other transportations. Alone. There were times they attacked me. There were times they tried to drown me in the river when I was baptizing the people. I have gone through so many challenging times, dangerous times in my life. But I can tell you today, in every situation of my life, the Lord's angels encamp me around. Amen. Why? The Bible says the angels are the ministering spirits. They are sent to minister to you. They are sent to minister to us, to me. They were there. I didn't know. God protected me. God stopped those people from attacking me. God stopped those people from killing me. Because the angels are ministering spirits. They have been sent to deliver us. Can you say amen to that? Think back for a moment. Think back the times that you went through where suddenly you did not know how you are saved, how you are protected in that situation, how your car did not tip over, how you came out of that car without a scratch, though you met with an accident. How? Because God sent His angels as a ministering spirit to deliver us. Amen? Look at the time when Jacob is on his way. Now the time has come for him to meet with his brother. He heard that Esau was coming towards him with 200 men. And he was so worried. He's frightened. You know the story of him fighting with an angel. But the angel has to press into his socket. And he wanted to be blessed. And you know the story of how the blessing came upon him, including the change of his name and his character. And the angel said, you will no more be called as Jacob, but you'll be called Israel. God just made you the prince of God. Prince with God. Hallelujah. And God said, I will take over. Because God saw his pitiful condition. And he sent a visitation of an angel. That's how it all happened. He pitied on the man because he was so worried about his brother. He thought his life is finished. The visitation of the angels. You know, the Esau still came with about 400 men with him. So the situation did not change, but God changed the attitude of the people. God did not stop Esau. God did not drove him away. No. He still came. But during the time, God changed the attitude of Esau. What happened? They came, they hugged each other. They cried over each other. No more enmity anymore. He said, "You are my brother." And he gave the gifts to Esau. And he said, "I will take care of you." Things changed because the visitation of an angel. Because God had pity on Jacob in his condition. Amen. You know the story of Elisha. When an army came to catch him, take him back to the king. And his disciple was so worried. He said, "Master, what are we going to do?" So Elisha said, "Don't worry. We got more people than the army," but he couldn't understand. So Elisha said, "Lord, open his eyes. I can see it, but he can't see it. So please open his eyes, Lord." And God opened the eyes of Elisha's disciples. And there on the mountaintop, all these horses, chariots, and there, the angels, army of angels, innumerable angels were there. And Elisha said, "Don't worry. They can take care of us. Nobody's going to stop you and me." Amen? Hallelujah. You remember Jesus talking to Pilate? What did he say? Pilate said, "I have the power. I have the authority to deliver you or to destroy your life. I can kill you." What was the answer to Pilate? Jesus said, "You know, you have no idea who I am. But if I will call out to my Father, he will send me 12 legions of angels to protect me." What is 12 legions? One legion is 6,000 angels. 12 multiplied by 6 is 72. 72,000 angels will be sent immediately from heaven. All you need to say is, "God, Father, I need some help. Send those angels." What can these angels do? In the Old Testament, we read at one time, God sent one angel to destroy the enemy. And when he came and when he killed, how many did he kill? 1,85,000 people, one angel killed. I don't have the time to do the maths. You can calculate 72,000 multiplied by 185,000. There'll be nobody left. Still the angels will be looking. Is there anybody else we can kill? My Father will send 12 legions of angels. Amen. Angels are always connected with us. Angels guard us. A home is a camp of the angels. You never knew, did you? You're thinking you're all alone. You're the only believer in the whole village. You know, everybody's angry with me. I'm walking out of the place. They're all getting angry, spiteful. But you never knew there are angels walking with you. Your house is covered with angels. Your house is my name, Don't forget, it's not only for Jacob, it's for you too, it's for me. I don't need to worry about. We need to face our fears boldly, knowing that the Lord has already sent his angels. Okay? Don't live in fear. Don't be frightened, friends. God has already sent his angels to you in every situation of your life. More so, in the situation we need help, God will send his angels to guard over us, and also he will further build our faith. Amen. Amen. If a person is surrounded by an army, then he doesn't need to be fearful, right? And we are surrounded by an army of angels. How much more secure we should feel because the angels are around us. When we know that you and I are never alone, that gives us the feeling of peace, protection, joy, and courage. That's what happens. When you and I know that God has covered us and God is protecting us. Amen. The army of angels are surrounding us all the time. We always need to know, greater is he who is in me than who that is in the world. Amen. Mechanaim, the camp of the angels. That's your house. That's your life. And may God bless us. Amen. Heavenly Father, we praise you and we thank you, Lord, for an amazing message. We don't need to be frightened. Lord, we don't need to feel lonely. We don't need to run. We don't need to think that the enemy is stronger. No. We are the strongest because you are with us. You have sent your angels to guard over us, Lord. Lord, give that assurance in the heart of everyone who is listening to this message today. I bless everyone, Lord. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. God bless you. Take care of yourself. We'll see you next week.